many days and many nights going home just crying to my mom and just telling her how cruel the kids are out there. I had no inkling or no idea that, you know, I wanted to pursue this as a career. You know, it was just a hobby. It was just something that I wanted to do. But unfortunately for me, you know, being small and trying to play a sport that didn't know at the time was supposed to have been meant for a bigger, taller player, you know, got a lot of criticism from it. You know, a lot of backlash, a lot of name calling, you know, which could affect which confidence. At the beginning, you know, it was challenging, it was tough, you know, many days and many nights going home, just crying to my mom and just telling her how cruel the kids are out there and, you know, how mean they were, you know, and but she was always, you know, always just quick to say that it had no idea what basketball was about, but she was quick to say, you know, Ty, I was Ty for her at the time, you know, Ty, they don't let them, you know, take your joy. If you like playing basketball, you go out there and play. You know, no one can be an expert on your life. They don't know how big your heart or know what your capabilities are. If you want to play, you just go out there and play. And at the time, I didn't know what that meant. I'm like, yeah, okay, Mom, but, you know, those things didn't register at the time. You know, I just focused more or less on the kids being so mean and cruel towards me, and because I was trying to pursue a game that they thought was meant for taller players. Little jokes that was out there, you know. You're short, you know, you need to be sitting on the curb with your feet swinging off, or, you know, we could put you in the drawer when we're traveling, you know. As they said, you know, you growing up as a kid, when they say sticks and stones may hurt your bones, but words would never hurt you. It's not true. Words will hurt you now, and they're killing folks. So words are very powerful, very powerful. So the thing is about getting within yourself and understanding who you are to kind of, you know, ward off those negative comments that's coming toward you, because, you know, as a kid, you know, you're not as strong, you know, as you are as an adult. So when I was a kid, you know, those things was very hurtful. And, you know, that was very deterrent at the time, but it didn't distract me. Because your heart, you know, it measures. It pretty much doesn't have a height to it. You know, it pretty much set the tone of who you are and what you're able to accomplish. You know, and the height factor was the game of basketball. So, you know, my heart was bigger than my height. So I didn't have no hang-ups on believing that I belong with, you know, the best of the best, you know, because my heart was just as, you know, just as big as theirs. I'm 5'3 at college. I didn't grow anymore. You know, I'm still 5'3, you know, from my 9th, 10th, 11th grade all the way up. You know, I stopped growing when I was 9 years old. I mean, my 9th grade, because I think I was 5'1 and then I got to 5'2, 5'3, but that was the, you know, extent of it. You know, no more extension for me in terms of height wise, but 5'3 was it. You know, I knew that I wasn't gonna grow much taller. My mom, my dad, my brothers and sister were short. You know, my dad was only 5'6. My brother 5'7, he's the tallest of the family. So I knew I was gonna be in that 5 foot range in terms of, you know, what the family structure was made of. So I didn't have no hangups on wanting to be tall. You know, I never wished I was tall. That was, kids don't understand that. I never wished I was tall. You know, people don't believe that, but, you know, I never wished I was tall. I just accepted who I was, and, you know, it was hurtful that I was getting short jokes and those type of things, but I never wished that I was tall. I just wanted to play basketball, you know, whichever way, if it had been a Division II, I'd probably been satisfied, but knowing the type of kid that I was and who I was and the competitive type of person, I wanted it all. You know, I wasn't just going to satisfy with what someone else had planned for me. You know, I want to create my own destiny, and I start to understand that I was in position to do that. And, you know, when I became 12 and 13 years old, you know, words never matter. You know, it came in one ear out the other. You know, I was on a journey. I was on my path trying to become this basketball player that no one felt like he had any, you know, any opportunity to do so. Because at the time, coaches were still in the mindset of big guards. You know, big guards was the key of running our program. So we was trying to break down those barriers, you know, trying to, you know, break the mindsets of these coaches and let them know that, you know, I can be just as impactful, you know, as at this size and run your program and just be just as effective as a taller player. So all those little things that I had to do that I did, you know, allowed me to be, you know, still impactful and change the game in that regards to where now my height is not being discussed so much. Each level you move up, you're facing tougher and stronger and better players. So, you know, high school, I was able to get through there. College, it was the same situation my freshman year. You know, I came off the bench, had to play behind Danny Young to learn from that. Guys were bigger, stronger, but the talent pool was pretty much equal that I thought that I was on the same playing field. But just a matter of learning and understanding what that level of that competition was about and how to understand it and how to, you know, be accepted amongst these guys now who see, you know, call your teammates, you know, on this collegiate level, which is in the ACC, which is the high, supposed to be the toughest conference, you know, in the land of basketball at the time. The kid coming from the inner city, you know, still 5'3", still being questioned, okay, he made it on the junior high school level, in elementary, he made it in high school, but now he's facing bigger, stronger, tougher players that's, you know, no longer, you know, on that high school level. These are almost close to men, that how he's going to compete with these guys. And, you know, for me, it was just a matter of just going out there and proving, you know, showcasing what I was capable of doing. You know, have to change my game in some regards, in terms of have to score more, you know, because you have to keep the offense or the defense, you know, balance-wise, off balance. And understanding that part, because I was small, I was different from all the other players. You know, it felt like I had to adjust to them, but really, they had to adjust to me because they never seen a guy my size playing against them. So, you know, that low to the floor, they had to protect the basketball. So, you know, and me understanding all this, what I'm impacted, how I'm impacting the game, it allowed me to really explore it and really take it to another level, to really start to get up in guys once they got the ball, not at half court, but at 94 feet, as soon as they take it out, and make them work to get across half court. So all those little things that I had to do that I did, you know, allowed me to be, you know, still impactful and change the game in that regards to where now my height is not being discussed so much. You know, if you look at whatever your weakness is, you got to try to turn it into a strength and not look at, let them know that this is a weakness. And the way I had it is, and the way I looked, did it was that, you know, guys see you small, they feel like they could post you up. I was just a strong little guy, but I knew that guards weren't comfortable playing with their back towards the basket. They don't have the fat man, the big man type of moves, and it only takes 3-4 seconds in order to play defense, in order for someone to help and for the game to get, you know, the ball to be moved. So having that understanding, having a high IQ of the game allowed me also to be at the, it'd be very impactful, so where guys couldn't feel like they was taking advantage of me, you know, and it took away from the big guys being down there. So it was a more of a, you know, a disruption of one's game plan from them trying to go down there and use it to where they trying to take the ball out of the big man hand and give it to a guard, which he's not comfortable doing. So it worked in our favor, in my favor. So having that understanding, you know, I just continue to keep, you know, exploring more and more. I don't care how small, how big you are, if that skill set don't match up with you leading and how you leading, you know, everybody's going to be second guessing you, calling you out. So for me, you know, I gained the respect of the guys because they knew and they felt like I was a true leader. You know, I was leading us in the right direction. I was an extension of the coach. And everything made sense to what I was saying in order for us to be the team that we wanted to be. And, you know, you always recognize, especially at that point guard position, you know, who's effective, you know, how effective he's been and how he's running the team and how effective the team is and how much chemistry that we have with each other and are we winning, you know, and that's what it all boils down. Then, you know, we was winning, you know, we had a lot of, everybody was playing their role and, you know, and it all, you know, that's how the chemistry was able to form and that's how you gain the respect from. So it was a, you know, a long road for me, you know, building that up to that point, you know, coming after my senior year, being able to go to some of the camps and build your name and put yourself on that, in that, that conversation that you could possibly be, you know, a first rounder, you know, because at the time I was a second round, late possibly first. And by having success at the camps that we was able to, you know, be invited to, the last one, especially in Chicago, where all the general managers, where all the owners, you know, mainly the, some of the owners come in and watch the players as opposed to getting the information from their scouts. But, you know, myself and Scottie Pippen at the time was on the same team. you know, both our stocks rose during that camp. He was projected late first, and I was projected late first, early second. You know, he wound up being the fifth player chosen. I wound up being the 12th player chosen. So that's how much our stock had risen from the performance that we was able to put up in Chicago. And that's where, you know, you start to really, you know, understand that, hey, this is real, you know. And the day sitting there, you know, hearing all the names being called, and then that 12th pick and hearing the Washington Bullets select the Tyrone Muggsy Bowles, you know, basically a place in my backyard where I grew up, being from Baltimore. You know, the weight of the world was lifted off your shoulders that day. You know, you felt like, hey, you know, this is what you've been striving for so long, and having the opportunity to go shake Commissioner David Stern's hand, you know, being eye level with him, and you know, being the first that they would do that, because we had all kinds of small guards come through our league, you know, the Spud Webb, the Michael Abbott, didn't get the opportunity to get drafted and go shake the commissioner's hand. So, you know, that was something that meant the world to me, and then meant the world to my family. Well, it changed our complete narrative of my family. You know, we no longer was, you know, in the low income bracket. You know, I was fortunate enough to get my mama, you know, a house, you know, get out the projects, and my dad and my sisters and my brothers, and we was able to, you know, live a better life, you know, and where it wasn't as challenging as it was when, you know, when they was growing up. So that was something that I was truly proud of, that I was able to do that for our family. And they've been very supportive, you know, all every step of the way. So I was so thankful that I was in a position there to do that. Keep playing. But while you're playing, learn all the nuances, all the information that comes with the game of basketball. Don't settle for what someone think that you should be doing. Understand what that position is, because if you're undersized two guard, all right, and you're undersized point guard or you're small guard, then you still have the ability to play the game. It's just a matter of how can I be impactful on that team? What do I need to do to be impactful and not stand out as a liability and not continue to be an asset? Small guards, it's a place for you everywhere on this court. You know, undersized players. I ain't gonna just say small, undersized players, because we had undersized players playing this game all day long. You know, you look at guys who are playing in the NBA, and let's take the NBA just for a moment. Draymond Green is undersized, playing his position. You know, you have those type of players that's undersized. You have, who else we got at undersized playing their position? Look at what you have with McCullough and Lillard, two small guards that's playing backcourt, you know, which you don't have the ability to put a 6'6 guy out there with them. But they are very impactful. You know, you have to change the game in a way defensively to where it can be very noticeable, so you're not being so well taken advantage of. Your ability to create space, your ability to make players around you better, that's a plus, that's a bonus. Your ability to knock down that shot, that's a bonus, that's a plus. That allows you to keep playing and keep being on the floor as long as you want to be. You know, if you look at whatever your weakness is, you got to try to turn it to a strength and let them know that this is a weakness. So don't get discouraged, don't get distracted in terms of people telling you you're too small.